IVM.
Hey everybody, welcome to an episode of the Geek Fruit Bulletin with me, Tejas. Today, Dinka and Jishnu are not in because they are preoccupied.
Yeah.
Some would say they're indisposed.
Good word.
And they're doing some other stuff. I seem to have the only free time in this goddamn show. But I have with me two guests filling in for Jishnu and Dinka. First off, it's our designer and more so our friend of the fruit. It's Alika. Hi.
Oh, hello.
Friend of the fruit is a thing, is it not?
It's very alliterative.
Yeah, it's like a blue frog. You know, it's a friend of the frog, and then you get discounts and stuff. Except here, you just get to hang with us. I don't know. There is no benefit of being our
friend. What about a free T-shirt?
Yeah, we can arrange for that.
Thanks.
That's easy. We're still looking out for the best email to give away a T-shirt. We also have another guest. It's Antariksh.
Hey!
Yeah, you are interim producer, Antariksh, by
the way. I am right now, yes.
Okay, cool. So because you know how the producer's position here is at
Geek
Fruit, right?
I know, yeah.
It's like the defense against the dark arts position.
Yes.
It changes every
year.
Well, not even every year. That's actually, they have a better batting
average. Every couple of months or so, there's a new producer.
Yes.
Yeah,
but as I keep saying, whoever becomes the producer of the Geek Fruit podcast is
Doomed to die.
Is also like, a friend of the frog.
Is a friend of the fruit, yes. And also goes on to do bigger and better things when they leave us. So,
oh, cool.
Invariably.
I'm looking forward to leaving you guys.
All right, Antariksh, since we haven't done a getting to know Antariksh episode, might as well do it quickly right now. So tell us about you. I have two questions for you once you introduce yourself.
All right.
One is, what's your nerd cred? Do you have any like proud geeky thing that you have?
Right.
And the second thing is, what would you pack for the apocalypse? I don't know why.
We've just been asking that. Cool. Yeah. My name is Antariksh Tucker. I am also a comedian, a stand-up comic.
Sweet! Yeah. That's a joke. I hate doing
not
that.
Right.
That's just putting everybody on the spot. No. Alright.
So I'm also a stand-up comic. Please come and watch me, watch my live shows.
Where do you perform? Tell everybody and where are you going
to... all over the city. Well, Habitat and Integral Space in Lower Parel.
Sweet!
With Comedy Develop. Yeah, come to all these places. Just search for me on Book My Show or Insider and you'll find...
Well done. Okay, cool. I didn't know you were a stand-up comedian. That's great. Yeah. Okay, cool. So so you're doing that also.
Yes.
What's your nerd cred?
I am a mega comedy nerd.
You're a comedy nerd.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Huge
so,
comedy nerd.
So you know everything about everyone's comedy.
I would say.
Do you do you watch all countries' comedians also? Like, that's what I usually consider. Like, as in someone who watches. Because I end up watching a lot of American stand-up comedians.
Yeah,
and then
I'm
just like, oh, I should really check out others.
The thing with me is I don't just watch stand-up. I watch comedy in every other genre of comedy. Basically, like, I'm inclined towards English only for the most part.
Okay.
So I watch only... A British, American,
okay.
Indian.
Is your comedy in English?
Yeah, it's mostly
okay,
English.
Sweet. Amazing. Okay, cool. That's great. So that's your note. What will be back in the apocalypse?
Back in the apocalypse.
Alika, you can also answer this. I don't know if you've told us this. Because we know you're nerd cred. You're a super nerd. No one has disputed that.
I am a niche nerd, y'all.
Let's see. In the apocalypse, how many things can I have?
Just to answer a question, niche nerd is nerd. Okay, that's the whole point.
It's like the nerd
what
of
is the
nerds.
What is the weirdest thing you can like that makes you nerd? Makes you more powerful. Anyway, as a nerd, what kind of apocalypse?
No. How many things can I have? Like how many items?
I mean, I would just pick one for now.
Okay, pick one for now.
Yeah, that's what I wish. Just one.
I think I'll need to survive. So probably like a good. A machete kit. Yeah, a kit of machetes.
A kit of machetes?
Yeah, it's just like kit. A machete is a badass weapon.
It is, yeah. And it's also used to cut crops.
Yeah, so multi-purpose.
There you go.
Works out.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, Alika, give me your.
Wait, I have to say this.
A kit of what will you carry?
I don't know. Like a Swiss knife? That's like the most sensible thing.
That's cool. Yeah, I like the multi-purpose. I would have said that as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know if I have said that, but yeah, that's a good option.
Yeah, I have like three Swiss knives at home, so probably one of them.
Why not all three?
Not going to ask. Oh, you kid of Swiss knives? Yeah. There you go.
Yeah,
you can be like you can have a Swiss knife in each arm and then one in your mouth, like Zoro from One Piece. If you guys are anime fans,
wow, yeah, there you go. All right, yeah, okay, yeah, cool. So that's some more nerd stuff.
Yeah, yeah. I used to carry them in my bag because I thought, you know, oh, it's such a cool protection thing, and then I realized it's they're probably going to kill me before I can take it out and then decide which tool to use to stab someone.
Well, I also used to carry one until you kind of have to keep relinquishing it at, like, you know, all these, you know, not metal detectors. They'll always find
mine.
It, and then they'll.
They have never
found
really?
Mine. Yeah. I used to carry one in college.
It's in a secret, like, compartment in
cool,
my bag.
Cool. All right. So, that is the first thing, getting to know Antariksh. First of all, fucking epic name.
Oh, thanks, Antariksh.
Yes. Doesn't it mean space?
Yes. It does mean space, yes.
So that's the greatest
we
name.
We have made
Antariksh, you are.
Many jokes.
You are the final frontier.
Oh, yes.
The final Antariksh.
The final Antariksh, yes.
No, also, there's a show called Final Antariksh.
Yeah, I know.
Also, there's an Antariksh bar on your keyboard.
Okay.
Thank you.
Wait, what do you know? Oh,
see,
okay,
sorry,
bar, yeah. Sorry,
you might
sorry,
want to
so
rethink
sad.
The comedy.
So
thing.
Bad.
All right, cool. Let's move on. There is something that I wanted to talk to Alika about. I don't know if you caught this, but there's a Japanese film festival which is happening as we speak.
Yep.
Which means you still have maybe 3 or 4 days to go catch it. If this releases,
it
this
ends
week.
On Sunday. Yeah. So you have like a few films you can go and catch yet.
Any particular movies you're looking forward to? Like, I saw Tokyo Ghoul, the
nice.
Live action.
How was innovation. It?
No, I saw it on the lineup. I didn't watch
okay,
the movie.
Okay, no, I've seen the movie yet. Yeah. So, yeah, I just found out through a friend, and it's very convenient for me. I stay in Andheri, and it's like right next to my house,
oh,
and
sweet.
It's free.
Yeah.
The only the trick is that because it's now in its third iteration, a lot of people have gotten wise to it. Like, a lot of people know. So, that really calm, chill film festival vibe where you want to, where nobody knows, and you can go and be a hipster and be like, oh, man, that's not there anymore, guys.
Yeah.
You know, because.
No, there's thousands of people. Yeah.
Because that is possible that this might be the last free year, right? Isn't that not possible?
I'm cool with that. This is what I was trying to explain to Alika the other day. I was just like, please make it expensive so that I can buy the tickets and no kids can come. So that I can just go aram se. Otherwise, but it's fine. I don't mind paying. If it was as proximal to me as it was and it was a ticketed thing, I mean, it's worth attending. I think if you just a delegate pass, well, totally worth going for.
Yeah, agreed. I'd pay for it.
I think there are about 3 or 4 movies every day.
Yeah, I think the weekends have like 4 movies, though a couple run concurrently.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But the weekdays have 2 movies. I think just a 5:30 show and no, a 5 o'clock show and a 7:30 show.
Okay, nice. And I actually really like the idea that it's specifically a Japanese film festival. And when they say it's not like Mami, where there's just like a variety of films from all around the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is exclusively from Japanese filmmakers. And what's so special about that is that apart from just like, you know, it's just introducing yourself to like a different kind of culture and stuff. I had to do a lot of reading after the film that we watched together just to know exactly, because there's so many things that you won't get, you know, offhand. You know, you kind of need to understand that that's not the way that we really experience like myths or fantasies and things like that.
Right.
They have their own. And it's just interesting to read about. So let's talk about movies you watched, Alika, quickly before we talk about The Witcher.
Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Also, one more thing. Are they showing only live action stuff here? Or is it
no, they're
animation
showing anime.
No, in fact, like, anime. I mean, part of the reason I wanted to go is to watch all the anime stuff that I could.
Exactly.
So so we saw one together. We saw, what did we call it? Lou Over the Wall.
Yep, that's
right. Wow.
It's about a guy who makes friends with a mermaid.
Yeah.
Which is not actually a mermaid. I looked this up later.
That's exactly what I was trying to say.
Yeah.
You know, like, even the mermaid's father later on, it's like a different looking, it's not like a merman, or, you know, it's like a weird, its
shark
own folklore. Yeah, it's a shark looking thing. And so tell us about the movie. Would you like it?
Oh yeah, I enjoyed it. I went to mostly see the animation stuff because that's my jam.
Yep.
I really liked the animation in this. It was super fluid. It was really, it kind of mirrored the whole underwater thing a lot, because a lot of the movie was on the waterfront and on the water, so the animation was super. The story was also, I mean, it was pretty linear and kind of obvious, but it was really nice. It was
a
good
pretty.
Fun time.
And I was just like, man, don't give me your gritty Japanese drama. I just want to see your surrealist fantasy stuff. Just give that now. And it delivered on that.
Yeah.
I think the cool thing about you know, just animation, anime specifically, man, they just have a free reign to do so many
weird...
They
push so many boundaries.
Absolutely, man. And you can't do that. Of course, you can't do that in any live action as well.
Yeah.
But it's beautiful how they construct this town and its various characters and all that stuff.
Right.
And like they all come into play towards the end. Yeah. Anyway, it was, I enjoyed it. It was like mostly like a kids-ish movie, but like there was a lot of like darker subtext that you could have taken
like
away
the
as
the main
adult.
Character is very obviously suffering from depression. This is like very obvious throughout the whole first half of the movie. And you see like how that kind of affects him, and then you know like how his outlook towards life is sort of reflected in that.
Yeah.
And then once he makes friends, or like rather his friends kind of try to pull him out of the shell, and it sort of works out a little bit.
And I like that he's a musician. I mean, it was about musicians. It was cool. Yeah. Like he's like doing like this, like he's uploading his videos to YouTube. It was very reflective of our like generation and stuff. So I like that kind of contemporary stuff, because most of like the classic Disney stuff is very rooted. It's like animals or like Disney princesses. So it's kind of like otherworldly. These ones are like super contemporary. Anyway, so that was one. Did you watch anything else?
Yeah, I watched two others. I watched Children of the Sea, which is also
I wanted to watch that. How is that?
Very metaphysical.
Okay.
Oh, yeah?
I did not expect that. It was extremely beautiful.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure.
Not as, you know, squishy and stretchy as Lou Over the Wall.
Okay.
So it was a little bit more grounded in its animation, I'd say.
Okay.
But
not messing with physics.
No, heck, it... Okay, so it was...
Oh, it totally does.
No. The first, let's say, two-thirds of the story was pretty linear, made sense to me. I understood what was the thing. It was like this kind of like angry young girl who ends up making friends with these two kids who were found at sea. They were raised by a dugong.
Oh, sweet. I love dugong.
Yeah, wait, not the Pokemon. I'm pronouncing it like the Pokemon. Dugongs.
Yeah, dugongs, the sea
cows.
Cow, yes.
Yes, so they were raised by a dugong, and then they were found by these scientists, and they were brought to an aquarium where this person's father works.
Okay.
And they kind of had to just, you know, grow up there for the rest of their lives. And they were, people were doing like tests and shit on them because they were not quite human.
Okay.
They had evolved a little differently.
The dugong?
No.
Oh, the children.
The children. The dugong wasn't found.
Yeah, I was just checking.
Yeah. Yeah, the kids weren't quite human. They had adapted a little differently.
Okay.
Mm. And then, so that's the first half where, you know, she kind of makes friends with them, and then she goes out to the sea and they show her all the cool shit that happens in the sea. And then there was a part where there was like a meteorite and one of them had swallowed it, and then he transferred the meteorite
to
the
girl. This is what I love about these films. They're so wild.
And then it became like this person ended up giving birth to a full new universe.
Love it.
It was very trippy.
That's so good.
So like there's a good 15 minutes which is super trippy.
I love that, man.
But it was awesome.
How long was the movie in general?
I think 2 hours.
I think most of these films are under 2 hours or 2 hours. So you get like, you know, some time to kind of really soak it in. And it's great. And there are no intermissions, which is also quite nice. Nothing strategically placed for us, so that's nice.
Yeah.
Cool, man. Dude, so anyway, if I think you guys want to go check it out, you have a couple of days to go do that. Go early. Here's a slight tip from Geek Fruit. Mm. Go early because there's a lot of kids. And when I say kids, I mean young people. A lot of people.
Sorry, I haven't been there, but so they have proper seating and all?
It's free seating once you get a ticket. Yeah, so they'll only distribute like tickets to as many seats as
possible,
there are.
Yeah,
but then in terms of like first come, first serve, so you're going to have to stand in line or get there early.
But you can't, like, if you come late, you can't like stand in the back and watch it or something like that.
No, I mean, this is not like
it's not an open drive through.
It ain't that. No, I mean, they'll only give out tickets for the same number of seats. And man, it was packed when we went the first time. So try and get there early if you do want to go. Cool. So that's that. We are not going to take a break because this is a bulletin, man.
Yeah.
So let's just move on.
Yeah.
Let's talk about The Witcher. Now, I have a few disclaimers.
Okay.
Why are we discussing The Witcher, a short review, on a bulletin as opposed to a full-blown episode? And the answer is because nobody I know watched it. And which is strange. When I say nobody I know, I mean Dinkar or Jishnu. I think Jishnu's tried, but he couldn't get into it. I think Dinkar also did not get into it.
Wait, are those two not fantasy fans?
It seems clear now. Okay. Well, you know, I don't want to say, oh, because they watch Game of Thrones, that means they are. I think Game of Thrones is,
yeah.
But having said that, Interestingly, though, Netflix put out a statement recently. And by that, I mean maybe like yesterday itself. And they said that The Witcher is one of their biggest TV series ever because through its first 4 weeks of release, 76 million people watched it. So it's it's their most watched first season on Netflix, which is interesting because I think, and they're kind of, I mean, like pundits and all are saying that, it's because Game of Thrones is over, so people still have an appetite for it. But, I mean, it's not at all like Game of Thrones in that sense. I mean, it's the world is similar in the sense that it's like this medievalish, it's fantasy. It's like an old-school English medieval kind of setting.
Yeah, correct.
But yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, but there's more magic than Game of Thrones was.
There's a lot more magic. Yeah. I mean, this is a proper fantasy tale. Okay. Yeah. And it's set, I mean, it's based on fantasy books. Yeah. It's got, you know, everybody knows about the games. Yeah, three games.
Which I feel is probably the reason why there's been such a big jump in watch. Because it's already got a fan base.
Yeah, correct.
A very solid fan base of people who play the games.
Absolutely. Like, and the books as well. Yeah. Plus, I did hear the reverse as well, that Steam, the game distributor, they saw a rise in sales for The Witcher.
Massive rise.
When the show came out.
That makes
sense. Is, I think, like somebody like me, which is that, you know, I'm just like, oh, I hadn't played The Witcher, but I saw the show and... Obviously, I like this kind of stuff. So I'm more inclined to play The Witcher now.
Yeah, I think what also something smart that they probably did was they did not copy the exact storyline from the video games.
No, because the video games is kind of set after the books.
No, I think the video games follow the books, but I think the most popular one, which is Wild Hunt.
Yeah.
That's three, and that's set like well later on, and this is still right at the top of the.
No, so what I'm saying is, had they adapted the exact story, then people would have not been as inclined to check out both the things, maybe.
Yeah, because
maybe totally a different story. Maybe
fair enough. Yeah, I think, and also we want to see like where it comes from. I think Amazon is doing the same thing with Lord of the Rings. They're not going to start at.
No, they're doing Silmarillion.
I think they'll do Silmarillion, and then get to Hobbit and then Children of Urien, yes, of course. So that's the setup for The Witcher.
Yeah.
Now the very important question to all of us who watched it and enjoyed it. Can we get everyone's opinion? Did you enjoy the show?
I really enjoyed it.
Enjoyed it, Alika? Yeah. I enjoyed it. Okay.
Yeah.
Is it good? Is the show good? And why did we enjoy it if we think that it's not up to standard? I will say this is my opinion. I don't think it's great.
Yeah, I agree.
But like I said,
it's not even Netflix's best show, I would say.
Oh, not at all.
Yeah, not at all.
Not even close. Netflix has a ton of amazing shows, right? Yeah. They have Mindhunter.
Yeah.
They have Daredevil, one of my favorites.
Yes.
But I did explain when Dinkar was asking me what kind of show it is. I was like, man, it's not Iron Fist bad, but it's like Luke Cage good. Right? And by that I mean, for anybody who's seen Iron Fist and Luke Cage, Iron Fist is a trash bag show. It's bad, right?
One of the storylines doesn't make any sense.
None of it makes sense.
Yeah.
I love it though. Like I mean, everyone has made this joke that I love average shit, but I like watching it because I love Iron Fist the character actually, and I love that comic book and I love Matt Fraction series. So it's great. I tolerate it because I'm like, wow, there's an Iron Fist show. I have to watch it. There's no way I'm not going to watch it. Similarly for Luke Cage. Now Luke Cage, the first season was so like random. I mean, it started well, but it ends pretty poorly.
Yeah.
And then the second season of Luke Cage, I think Chiyo Hidari Koka, the creator, I think he just leaned into how weird and bizarre the world is, and they made like a Godfather-esque arc for the cat. It's like insane.
Wow.
And I always recommend it for people who are willing to watch something absolutely weird and bizarre. Like, I wouldn't recommend Iron Fist, but I would like recommend Luke Cage because it does something really like what CW does with its shows in the Arrowverse, which is that once they realized that they were not making the epitome of like superhero action shows, I think they just leaned into how like camp it was, and the same thing happens for Luke Cage. I think that's kind of the space that The Witcher is in. It's not great for me personally.
Correct.
But there's something incredibly watchable about it.
Yeah.
Do you agree? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I do want to point out, freaking Luke Cage and Iron Fist was the reason I didn't end up watching the whole
Defenders
thing. And wait, I really wanted to.
Defenders also, not good. but I enjoyed the shit.
Yeah, same.
When I saw the four of them together, yeah. I was like, this is what I want, man. Exactly. Just give me what I want.
Yeah. No, those two put a halt to my Marvel TV series watching.
Okay, I will say this. If you want to redeem it, The Punisher Season 1, Season 2, and Daredevil Season 3. Daredevil Season 3 is by far... I mean, I still talked about this to anyone who will listen to me. But Daredevil Season 3 is the best. It's so good. And it concludes... Daredevil is a great show.
Yeah, I love Daredevil. Yeah. I watched it like 3 times. So
you can watch the 3rd season.
It might be coming back on Disney Plus, right?
It makes no sense.
So they have to wait a stipulated like 2 or 3 years. I don't know what the a gestation period before it comes onto Disney. I think that's just the way that the deals were made. Yeah. Because everybody loves Charlie Cox as Daredevil. Yeah. Everyone would love to see him in like imagine when they do Moon Knight or something and then the Daredevil just shows up.
Imagine if they have a crossover between the Ben Affleck Daredevil and the Charlie Cox Daredevil.
No. Well, awesome.
If Ezra Miller can show up So tell me what you guys thought about The Witcher and why do you think you enjoyed it even though you kind of agree it's not the best.
But what I think The Witcher does great is smaller moments are very there are enough great moments
I agree
on the show.
I completely agree.
Like for instance are we doing this spoilers?
Let's not completely spoil.
The courtroom scene.
Yeah,
the battle in the courtroom.
Lovely.
Oh, dude, it was so well done. So well done.
Yeah.
I saw the entire battle, like, literally, I saw it once, and then I saw it again immediately. I was like, dude, that was great. I want to see it again.
I think Henry Cavill is pretty fucking great.
Badass.
Yeah,
as
he's
hell.
Great. Yeah.
How many? The grunts and the.
Just
and the.
F- yeah, he's just like. What do you think, Alika? Do you think he's a good Geralt of Rivia?
I heard one of my favorite comments was Roach played his character perfectly on the show.
Roach is amazing.
MVP Roach.
But Henry Cavill, man, I think he works for the show.
Yeah, I mean, there were so many jokes made about his casting, and I was like, I don't know that much.
I actually love him as Superman. I think he's a good actor, right? He's great in Mission Impossible. He's good in
Man from Uncle.
He's great in that. He's a good actor.
I do want to point out that Geralt doesn't really need that much variation or depth. He's got this pretty sort of one standard.
Fair enough. Like, absolutely.
Outlook.
Yeah, he doesn't need to express that much.
Yeah.
I think, but, you know...
He was good.
But a lot of charisma required to play that character. Sure. This guy has it, man. Like, in spades.
Yeah, you don't need to like this guy because he can be a total dick. But you are compelled to like him because he's the hero, right? Yeah. Like, he's not of his own making. Like, you know, that's the whole setup of The Witcher is that he's a mutant. And, you know, there's always some sympathy for people who haven't chosen the life that they have, but decide to do it anyway. And he kind of comes... You know what my thing was, like, it's... And I compared this arc to the Mandalorian a little bit.
Yeah.
That both the Mandalorian and the Witcher are two, so to speak, bounty hunters. And you know, these shows kind of came out at roughly the same time, so it was impossible for me to not compare it.
Yeah. Right.
But both of them were stated at the outset to be like, oh man, I'm not one of your good guys. But both of them essentially do the same thing, which is like, if somebody asks nicely enough, both of them are just like, all right, I'll do it. It's like, I'll help you. It's like,
begrudgingly.
Yeah, begrudgingly. I mean, like,
I guess.
But yeah, because there's nothing else that he's done apart from the first episode.
Mm-hmm.
With Renfrey and, you know, the Blaviken situation.
Yeah.
There's nothing else so dastardly that The Witcher does to make him like this morally grey character. I mean, he's just like a grump. Okay. He's just a khadoos, man. That's it. Yeah.
He's just like, man, I just want to make my rent.
Yeah, exactly.
Just pay me
just
for my
stuff.
Just
toss a coin.
To your Witcher.
Yeah, how about that song, huh?
That was so catchy.
I mean, like, how did that explode? Like, I was just like, oh, cool, this is a song. And then I started singing it randomly while I was walking around. And Dinkar's like, what the hell are you singing? And I was just like, I have no idea.
I have heard the best remixes of it. Y'all hit me up, I will share those remixes.
Nice. Yeah, there's some metal stuff and all. Yeah,
that reminds me, again, great supporting cast on the show. Great supporting characters on the show.
What did you think of... Let's talk about Yennefer, of course. And let's talk about Ciri. And
Yaskia.
So who was your favorite character and why? Like, because I felt I liked Yennefer. Pre-op.
Yeah,
pre-op with Yennefer.
Okay.
Was cool.
Yeah, okay.
Because she, we see an endearing quality to her because she was just like, you know, she's got a bit of a hunchback. She's kind of like deformed and, you know, but she's still got so much potential.
Yeah.
And then in a fit of rage and this huge chip on her shoulder, she's just like, I'm going to fight the world, I'm going to get better, blah, 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 and all that stuff. Yeah. And then she becomes, I'm not sure if that's what she's like in the books or the game.
Yeah, she is.
But I suppose she is. So I was into it. Then she becomes like super powerful, and then I'm just like, okay, cool, she's just like a powerful character now.
Yeah. Also, she's like lived a long time.
Let's talk about this timeline though, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Did that mess with you?
Like, it did initially.
It did, right?
But then once you figure it out, then it's fun to that. Yeah. In hindsight, it's good that they did not mention every time.
What was so awesome is that the timeline of the show is so skewed,
yeah,
but they lead it up so perfectly at the end. Yeah. Like the last episode, it kind of everything just lines up and you're just like, oh, okay, I see what you did. And that's great. I enjoy that.
Like the end reminds me that of a series character though. I did not like that much. It felt like removed from the main story.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah.
Even though her arc was very important to the show as a whole, every time we went to her character, I felt like, oh, we are actually now out of the main world or something like that.
Yeah. Did you feel the same way? Like, did you feel like she... Because it's a long story, so I assume that she's gonna...
Correct, eventually
will meet up with Geralt.
Yeah.
But what did you think about her arc?
A little bit. I felt it was... Because it... ends up, this is a little bit of a spoiler, it takes place in a fully different timeline and you don't see any of the supporting cast. So you're like, okay, I'm not sure when this is happening. I ended up figuring it out around episode 5,
I think, by the time when Geralt finally enters the court and the whole law of surprise and all that stuff, when that scene happens, when you're just like, oh, okay, cool, I get it, like this is like oddly skewed. And in fact, like Yennefer's entire, she's like lived for like 150 years by this time, you know. Just like, wait, what? But that's the brilliance of the fantasy genre. I like that they're leaning in really hard into it.
Yeah.
Like one of my favorite scenes right at the top of the show, because I wasn't entirely sure what the Witcher's powers were.
Yeah.
But like when he's kind of cutting down these guys in Blaviken, and then he's just like, he's using a sword, and then suddenly does some force magic or some shit. I was like, yo, this shit is amazing. Yeah. I was like, that's so cool. Yeah. I love that shit.
That fight scene was amazing.
It's up there in terms of one of the best parts of the show.
I keep saying this again and again about the show is the individual fights, one-on-one fights are great.
Yeah, yeah.
There's like, I think a couple of bigger battles are there on the show, which aren't that great because their budgets, I imagine, are not that big right now.
Yeah, not yet, for sure.
But imagine the second and third season, those will also become much better.
I would like to point out the choreographer is not returning for second season.
That's what they said. Yeah. That's okay.
Well, hopefully they get Anthony and Joe Russo or something. I don't know.
I mean, it doesn't matter. There are plenty of talented people to take it forward. In fact, maybe it could just become better.
Yeah.
I think obviously every first season in a sprawling genre piece like this has to do so much table setting.
Correct.
You know, you kind of, like for me, if you ask me, oh, what's the name of all the kingdoms and all the people,
I can't
keep track of it, even though I really want to. So I'll probably like read the book or play the game just to familiarize myself. But I can't imagine for those who are watching it, I don't know if they're disappointed or they're enjoying this interpretation of it, but I think it's pretty cool, man. Like it's a well lived in world and it seems fine.
What do you think of the monsters in the CGI?
I think it was fine. I mean, really, the thing about CGI, and I say this across the board, is that if the story is good enough to sell it, it doesn't matter how good or bad it looks. Like for me, it's just like, okay, cool, this is part of the story now. It's not a judgment of how good the artistry is in terms of that. I mean, though, of course, it's pretty up to standard. One of my favorite scenes, but the whole gold dragon thing, that was a really cool episode.
Yeah, because but the dragons was the only ones I did not find that great.
But just to make my point, which is that I like the character enough for me to not consider that to be like really a thing. Yennefer's powers just like explode into anything. She's super OP and stuff, right?
Yeah.
But it's like, okay, if it suits the story, it's fine. But towards the end, I was just like, all right, cool. I'm not really. You know what I really hope for this show is that they don't have to do much. Like in terms of like crazy like ideas, oh, this tree drops a fruit that will grow. I was like, no, but like simple concepts like they have, like of if you have to use magic, something has to die for you to take that magic away, right?
Yeah.
That's a very simple idea.
Yeah, that's right.
And I think they need to build on those kind of like concepts, like small concepts of that really ground the world into its own physics or its own laws, you know?
Yeah.
And I think like law of surprise is like a cool idea, which they are like like they have made the entire arc of Geralt about that. Yeah. So I'd like to see more of those kinds of elemental kind of rules that dictate this universe. I think that would be really nice. But yeah, man, I mean, like, the show is not without its faults. I think, you know, and Alika and I discussed this as well, but there's like a lot of gratuitous nudity yeah. in the show for really not any yeah, reason at all, yeah. except I guess getting viewership. Yeah. But
then maybe next season you'll see Henry Cavill's dong, man.
Yeah, I'm saying, okay,
listen, they put him in the bath twice, so yeah, I mean, that's
exactly. about to happen. Yeah,
just, no, I'm just, that is a thing. That is a thing yeah. in the game.
Yeah, I know.
So, exactly. Yeah, that's when you like chill out and heal and stuff, right? Yeah. My thing is like, unless it's necessary to the story, I feel like, what is the point? Like there is for me, there is no point. And it's not just because, oh, it's this medieval Spartacus setting that you must show, you know, nudity and stuff like that. I'm just like, no, it doesn't make sense. Watchmen, on the other hand, okay, has nudity from, like, you know, one of the characters, but you know that that's required. Like, that's part of the story in some sense. I can't give without giving it away, honestly.
I was super thankful though that The Witcher did not do rape scenes. Thank you, whoever decided that.
Oh my gosh,
that.
Yes, absolutely. I didn't think that. For me, it seems like a much lighter ask than Game of Thrones, right? Like Game of Thrones, I think this is why maybe
Game of Thrones tries to be super gritty and realistic.
No, and Game of Thrones is a great show. I won't take anything away from it. Yes, it has so many faults. It has so many issues.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about like just the writing.
Scene.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the show is great.
Yeah.
In fact, I think it gets a bad rap these days because everyone is just constantly shitting on Game of Thrones. It's like, you know, they gave you 7 amazing seasons of television, man. Really? And you lived and died by these episodes.
Yeah.
So don't shit on it now, man. And they give so much to D.B. Weiss and, you know, D&D, basically.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, so when people kind of exited the whole Game of Thrones thing, just feeling like, now I do have to start from scratch again. And I think The Witcher is a good antidote to that in some way. That it's like, it seems like kind of light, like Game of Thrones light.
Yeah.
Like characters like Yaskier and they're cool.
I think like a character like Yaskier provides a really good foil for
Geralt.
So it becomes kind of like a buddy cop thing.
Yeah.
Which worked so well.
And
also all your episodes are basically more or less like a monster of the week thing.
Pretty much. It's like this it's like Mandalorian in many very similar, right? Like, cause it's very it is villain of the week, but it's also very much in the vein of an RPG, like an actual game, which is like quest, side quest, main quest, you know, that's exploration.
Yeah.
That's basically it. And upgrades. Like just powers and stuff like that. So I think that's cool to watch. It's kind of bringing me back to old school kind of television, like Mandalorian did. I know this one has a pretty tricky timeline. But it, you know, like I didn't have to binge this guy or like I didn't have to go like, oh shit, what happened in the previous episode? I can't remember. I was just like, next episode. Yeah.
Correct, yeah.
And it's short enough and not offensively long enough for us to be like, oh, what a slog.
Correct.
I think it breezed by. Yeah. For me, I think that's why I watched it.
I watched it in 2 days.
Oh, there you go.
No, it was easy to watch.
You binged it?
Yeah, I binged it. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Like again, over 2 days, but like I saw like 4 episodes and then 4 episodes.
What is the cutoff date for binging? By the way, is it like everything after 2 days is not binging? It's like if you watch, there has to be a mathematical formula of X number of episodes divided by number of days equals to this is a binge watch.
No, but I just assume that binging is anything more than one episode is a binge. And after that, I didn't binge the entire show in one go.
So
I binged a few episodes in one
go. What about like shows which have 15-minute-long episodes?
Oh, that I binged like mad. Especially Adventure Time. Oh my gosh. Or Steven Universe. Just like knock them out. This one, like four,
so
five.
So does that count as binging?
That's why this formula is required. Geek Food will do this one. Okay. This is my contribution to the Earth. This is so sad.
Max.
But I think anything after like 3 episodes. But it also depends on how long the episode is. Like you said, yeah. Like I did this show in a week. And it was fine, man. It was good. Yeah. In fact, you know, it was one of those things where, you know why this worked for me, this show?
Yeah.
It's just like, I was scrubbing through Netflix and I was just like, oh, what do I watch? And then The Witcher show, I was like, oh, great. Here's a random show. I don't, zero pressure, can start from scratch.
Yeah.
No, you know, clue about what's happening. I was like, let's go. And then I went. And then whenever I knew I have to finish season 2 of Mindhunter, I need to finish this thing, I was just like, I don't feel like doing that. So I just put on Witcher and I just enjoyed it. So I hope the stakes become a little bit bigger. There's some nice open endings for some of the characters, Yasuke, Yennefer included. So
basically they've been following the first two books, which is actually a pretty much like an anthology of stories of The Witcher.
Yeah, I like that. That's cool. So,
and then after this, after these two books, which I guess they've covered in the first season, there's like a long form story.
Oh, so that'll be cool. Yeah. That's nice. So are you these are the first two books, the whole two books have been
more
done
or less? No, not all the stories, but like I guess they picked and chose the better ones.
Of course, yeah, yeah. And now they'll kind of maybe they can adapt some parts.
And now then there's like four books, which is like a long like quadrology. What's like a
quadrology? Yeah.
Is that a word?
That's what we used to say after Alien Resurrection came out.
Are we sure?
Yeah. The quadrilogy. Get it today.
I think they called it cycle at one point. Do you remember like Eragon? They had, it was first supposed to be like a trilogy, and then they added a fourth book, and then it became the Inheritance Cycle.
Yes. Oh, cycle. Nice. Yeah. I like that. Saga, I guess, is another word. There's so many words.
Yeah.
There's so many words.
Could have been a quadrilogy also.
Star Wars is like a something. It's like 9 films plus 2 more. Anyway. Alright, cool. So, final opinion on The Witcher. Would you recommend it?
Highly recommend it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
It's a very fun watch.
Very fun, breezy watch. What about you, Alika?
It's good. It's a little campy, but it's fun. It's a little formulaic. But do watch it. It's good for your fantasy nerd needs.
Nice. I liked it, man. I like fantasy as much as, you know, I'm a big Lord of the Rings fan.
Yeah.
And that makes me, I suppose, by fantasy people quite basic.
Mm-hmm. No.
But, yeah, well, yes. I mean, Lord of the Rings is like, oh, I'm a huge fantasy fan. I watch Lord of the Rings. I'm just like, no. That's like, that's one part. Like, Amit is IVM Podfather. Amit is like a fantasy king.
And
he really knows his stuff. And I'm sure if I went to him and told him I like fantasy. But I'm, you know what? He watched The Witcher as well. So, and he enjoyed it. He quite enjoyed it. So I suppose this has got a stamp of approval from a D&D person, from a fantasy person, from a basic fantasy person.
Yeah.
And are you into fantasy a lot?
Not that much. But I've seen a fair share. Like, I've seen the LOTRs.
Okay, there you go. So you're like me.
Yeah,
so boom. So I think it works across the board. Don't go in with much expectations. You'll be rewarded. I think that's what happened. Alright, cool. Thank you so much, Antariksh, for being on the show. Alika, a pleasure as always.
Thank you.
Don't forget to catch the rest of the Japanese film festival happening in Andheri. If you're in Bombay, it's free. Just go in early, get your ticket, go watch some good films, embrace a new culture, watch The Witcher.
Yes.
Also, one quick note, in case you guys are interested in the Japanese film festival and you are feeling too lazy to go, from February 1st Netflix is showing Studio Ghibli films.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, sweet. Very good.
Yeah.
All of them?
So they're going to release it in batches. So on February 1st, they're going to release about 6 films, and then March 1st, 6 more films.
Oh, shit. I think it's time for a marathon.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, cool.
I'm going to make this whole office watch Studio Ghibli. Like, y'all have not.
But then, Alika, you won't feel cool anymore. Once everybody watches it, you'll be like, oh, no, everyone.
Like, the fun is to share it with people.
I know. I'm being a hipster. Doesn't mean you are. It's fine. I'm not a hipster, dude. We do this show for everyone, man. Come on. Yeah. All right. Yalla, very good show. And we will see you guys on Monday with our full episode, which we don't know what we're doing. Might be doing Dracula, we'll see. All right. See you later, you nerds.
How many times have you caught yourself googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.
This is the amazing story of something awesome. Once Chuck decided to start a podcast, and so he did. The end. Okay, that was a crappy story. But I've got some really cool stories over at my new show, The Origin of Things. On this podcast, I look at the stories of how brands came into being and sometimes evolved out of quite unexpected circumstances. And to make it really fun, I reveal the name of the brand and sometimes a category only at the very end. The show is 5 to 7 minutes per episode and perfect for trivia junkies and brand nerds, especially those with short attention spans. New episodes out every Wednesday on IVM Podcast app or website, or any podcast app or site that you happen to prefer. End of story, they lived happily ever after.